Okay.
Yeah, Russell, we are live on Facebook. You can start.
You're live. Okay, hello all. Good evening. Welcome you all to PhotoWork Bengaluru. And I don't want to talk much about PhotoWork Bengaluru. As you all know, now this is our third webinar going on. And this time we'll be having a perception of nature. And to do this, we have with us the prominent Uday Hegde, the best person to talk about nature and the photography of nature. Okay. We are sorry that we are late by 5 minutes. There are a few others also who are joining. I think they will be joining in later. I have a few rules for all to follow, okay, during this webinar. As always, it is like, keep your mics mute. When the session is going on, there won't be any question and answer going on. And so all the mics has to be muted. And the second thing is that please put off your videos when the session is going on. And if you have any questions to ask, we have the last 15 minutes or so for question and answer, so you can ask your questions directly with Uday. And please note down the whatever questions you have, okay, so you can ask them later during the question and answer session. And let me introduce to you all Uday Hegde. One, most of them must be knowing Uday Hegde. And I don't think I need to introduce Uday, as he can say about him himself. Okay, Uday, to be in short, is a SAP technical architect by profession. He lives in Bangalore, and he is from a village in Sirsi, which is in North Canara district of Karnataka. And I think Uday, instead of me introducing you, it would be better you talk about yourself.
Yeah, definitely.
You are
definitely
the best person to introduce yourself. Okay. So, yeah, Uday, you can take over.
Yeah. Thanks, Russell.
Yeah.
So I am not that famous personality, Russell. So I think you got the wrong person. Okay. So first of all, thanks everyone for having me here. I'm really honored to be here, and hope I'll not bore you for next an hour or so. If you feel that it's enough in between, you can let me know. That's completely fine. Okay.
Yeah.
And so yes, I belong to a place called as Sirsi. So some of you might be knowing. So it's in middle of Western Ghats. So I was born and brought up here, and I even finished my schoolings and college here. So it's a kind of a forest or a hilly area. Okay, so that's why like I used to watch a lot of wildlife in and around my house. So when it comes to wildlife, it need not necessarily a tiger or a leopard, but it can be anything which is not tamed, right? So it might be a snake or a frog, even an insect. So even that's wildlife. So I think like there is some misconception telling that only wildlife is bigger mammals, but that's really not true. So I grown up watching those tiny creatures or a small one which is ignored kind of thing. So, and then I currently stay in Bangalore. I work as a technical architect for an IT company. And, but I continue to watch them even today. So I, that passion did not go away even after moving to Bangalore. So I try to make myself available over a weekend. So to travel, and whenever my job permits, I take some days off and I travel across India. So mainly Western Ghats and northeast part of India, and even central India for some of the the big cats. Okay. So today what I'll be doing is I'll be presenting kind of mix of all things. Okay, there will be more insects or a frogs or snake, and along with that there will be some tiger and the birds, everything. Okay, so mainly from the perspective what I saw them as. Okay, so but why I'm telling is like the perception is a very very interesting word for me, because like there are a lot of things, right? Like it's all depends on how you see things. Like the different people might see some things in a different way, so it need not necessarily like everybody should see the same thing. So that's why like I always consider that in my perception of the nature, like how I saw them. So I always try to bring the essence of what I saw on the field to my photographs or to my viewers through my photograph. That's the try. But every time it might not be really possible to do that because of the different aspects where you are and what kind of subject you are shooting at. So, but I always make sure to try at least to get the same essence to my viewers. That's one thing. And the next is like, as a photographer, like there will be, I feel that like there are majorly three kind of photographers. The one who clicks whatever they see, and the second one who clicks for some scientific reason or in publication or in scientific paper, like they need to keep the subject intact, or like they need to show even from the point of like, it might not be an artistic image, but like you need to keep the originality to great extent, because like somebody else will be looking at you from the studying point of view. So that's why like it makes a lot of sense to keep the color and the shape or like the subject where the natural habitat and like those things very much intact, because like your change in the image can really create a problem for somebody who is trying to learn that subject based on your image. Okay, and the third one is called as photo artist. Okay, where you are really not bound by any of these kind of rules. Okay, you have an creative freedom when you are shooting something, but creative freedom does not mean that like you can harm your subject. Okay, you are free to create anything inside your camera, not by destroying or disturbing the subject. That's what I mean by creative freedom. So I try myself, like I feel I'll fall into that category, because it need not necessarily an 100% accurate color or a shape, because what I feel it looks good for me, that I capture. So since I call myself as a photo artist, so it need not like to everyone should like my image, because like when you talk about an art, it's not necessary that everybody will have the same view of what you have. So, but like at least end of the day, if you are able to feel something good about your image, that's a really great thing. So some image you might like it, some you might not like it. There is no hard feeling in that. If you don't like it, that's completely fine.
Uday?
Yeah.
I think it's you're sharing the screen?
No, I'll start sharing now.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. So let me share, and then I think like we can start talking on this. Okay, so. Okay, let me know once you can see my screen. I will.
Yeah, we can see your screen.
Okay, great. Okay, let me just hide this panel. Okay, so that's coming in my way. Okay, so good. So now I just want to move this part. I don't know why. Okay, so in this show, I'll be showing images in majorly four categories. Okay, I call them. So one is with the natural light. Okay, every image what I show in this category are shot with natural light. There is no artificial light or anything used on them. And the second category is like with the combination of natural light and artificial light. Okay, so I might have used some torchlight or some artificial lighting source for that along with the natural light. And the third one is completely using artificial light. So because I shoot a lot of things in night, so there I don't have any option to have a natural light. So that's why I use artificial light on a lot of things. So I'll be showing in images in this particular categories, okay, how I shoot them, and I'll try to explain what happened behind the scene sometimes, or like wherever it is interesting, or like how I plan my shots. Okay, so without any delay, I will start my presentation. The first image what you see is like these are all layers. Okay, so the thing is like this was shot somewhere near close to my hometown. So I was just on an evening. In fact, I was waiting from like morning 6 to almost like evening 6:30, waiting for hornbill to fly on this canopy or this area. Okay. So, but unfortunately, I could not get any hornbill that day. But I got this shot somewhere in the evening, because like when it was having that multiple layers and the slight mist on winter day, you can see that like the mist is coming in between those layers. So I thought like it looked very interesting. And in the end of the frame, you can see that like sun's the heavy sun rays. So that's why like here you can see the more darker area and the gradual increase in the light and the contrast, which like made very interesting, like it made the image look very interesting to me. So that's why I shot it. And sometimes you don't have to be using a very wide lens to shoot the landscape, and like you can shoot it with even the longer lens. So this was shot with 500 f4 lens. Just to give an a heads up, like I use Canon equipment from my side. Okay, so all my shots are either shot with Canon 5D Mark IV or with 6D, and I have different lenses to use with. And so there is camera is just an equipment. Just remember that, like whether you use Canon, Nikon, or Sony, or any other brands like Olympus or anything, it doesn't make any much difference. So it's your brain and how you plan your shot that makes difference. So this is like just to answer the basic question, which equipment I use. Okay. So and good part of my photography journey is like I walk all these forests. Okay, because in search of a lot of different insects, snakes, I walk all this forest like by every time, like even in monsoon or winter, because I walk a lot in this forest. Maybe a day I walk somewhere around 17 to 18 kilometers in search of snakes or something else. So this forests are very, I'm familiar with this kind of forest. Oh, sorry. Okay. So, and thankfully on the next day, I could get a couple of images of even great hornbill, as well as this is Malabar hornbill. And any question?
Members, okay. Yeah. It's mute there.
Yeah. I think somebody by mistake. Okay, that's fine. So I could get a few images, so which one of them I'm showing here. So from my photography, whether it's a natural light or an artificial light, like light makes a lot of difference. Okay, so what I feel is you are just, I think there's a famous quote by a famous photographer, like it's photography is nothing but you are painting with light. So I take that very seriously. So wherever I try to shoot, either it should be very creative when the lighting is not really good, or like subject should be very interesting, or else like the light plays a very important role when you create images. So this kind of lighting will give you an pictorial kind of feel, where you call it as a storytelling image. So I always try to get that. So even though I'll not be successful all the time, but I try to get that on a regular basis. So why I shot this very wide, I could have shot it or cropped it much more smaller, because like these are all the canopy birds, like they fly high and they fly on an cliff kind of thing. When you're standing on a cliff, like you can really see the whole canopy or a forest area where they fly really high. So I wanted to portray that they are flying against an forest where the winter forest, you can see the leaves, which are tender kind of leaves, which is yellow, and the light which is coming from the left hand corner, so which is coming the evening setting light, which is falling through this particular trees, passing through the trees, and like even the lighting the white part of the bird. Okay, and why I told about the perception. So the thing is, like, this is a mushroom which I shot in Munnar last year. So I was shooting this mushroom in this way, and like then suddenly there's a lot of trees, like pine kind of trees, which were very tall, and this mushroom was very tiny. Okay, so then I changed the angle of my shot, and then like something became very interesting. This is the same mushroom which I shot from the different angle. That's it. Like, this was shot with a 15mm lens, and this was on a slight rainy day, and because of the high elevation it was clouded with mist, and you could see that, like, literally rainwater falling on my lens, and you can see this blurs are just because of the rainwater which has fallen on the lens. So I was pointing my camera upwards or towards the sky so that, like, I get most of the tree in frame. Okay, and the early mornings in winter is always an amazing thing to have, like when light is passing through the mist covered forest, that looks something amazing. And the trees, if you are in somewhere in central India, this was shot in Kanha National Park this January. Yes, so and those pine or salt trees, what they call, so they are pretty straight and they'll have hardly any branches in the beginning. So they make a very interesting pattern when you see it, like with mist struck in between those trees, and the light passing through them makes very interesting. So I try to make these kind of images on a regular basis. They look very interesting. And I don't use auto white balance when I'm shooting. From the technical point of view, I try to use the white balance on a Kelvin level, like I usually set the Kelvin level. Okay, so whenever you have morning, early mornings or late evening, so you'll have somewhere around 7500 to 8000 Kelvin temperature. So it's better you once you get familiar with that, that's more easier. So a lot of people say that we can do this adjustment in Photoshop or like Camera Raw, but I feel more comfortable using it on camera than the post-processing. Okay, so natural light plays very important role. So yes, like when it comes to my macro photography and all, a lot of people will say that, like, using a flash or a diffused light will be a very easier thing to do. But what I suggest, as in, if you are an young photographer or a very young to photography field, or you're learning the photography, so then I would suggest to go with the natural light in the beginning, because like learning the light is very, very, very essential thing in the photography. Like, if you know the angle of the light, which time, what light will come, the light temperature, like the morning temperature, afternoon, what temperature will be there for light. So then you can use those light, or even the situation to your advantage. So that's what makes most of the great images, like light and the shadows. That's what makes more interesting. So that's why, like, initially I would suggest to go with and learn the natural light in the best possible way. Once you are very much familiar with the natural light, you can play with any sort of light. Like, you don't have to have a flash itself. You can even use the mobile torch or a mobile flash as an light source for your image, or even you can use any of the torches. So that's why, like, if you know the angle of the light and the color and temperature of the light, that will help you greatly when you are doing the photography. So this was again shot in Kanha. This was on a morning, like early morning, 7:30. Kanha is just absolutely beautiful when in the winters. Okay, so it's always mist covered, and the golden light which is passing through that mist. So it is just you don't have to have a very interesting subject or an or in a very majestic subject in your frame. Even a very simple spotted deer can make a very interesting frame. So it's all, everything is completely in the how you frame it. So the whole composition and the framing and the subject, what you include in your frame, that makes a lot of difference. Okay, this is again shot in Khanna, not this year, last year or a year before that, because I try to visit Khanna almost every year, somewhere in the January or end of the December, because if you know Khanna very well, so I think like somewhere in December, after mid of December and between 10th of January, there will be a frost or like temperature reaches 0 degrees for a day or two. Okay, and my wish is to photograph Barasingha with a complete frost, and where the literally ice cubes I can, or a frost I can see on their body. Even the complete grass will be covered with frost. So, but unfortunately, I was not that lucky to get that image yet. So hopefully, I'll try again. So that's what. So this image was made before even sunrise, somewhere around 6:30, if I'm not wrong. And this Barasingha. So Barasingha was just coming out of an kind of a deep area, and it was just climbing that burn. So I just framed it in such a way that it falls between these trees, so that trees will not merge with the Barasingha, but like still you can see the tender leaves of the trees and the just first light rays which is coming and falling on that. Okay, so this is again in I like a lot of minimalistic kind of images where subjects are tiny, because they are very much tiny when it comes to the nature. So for us, like if you see it in a 500 mm lens, they might look really big, but when you consider them as a creature, like they are very, very tiny when it comes to the overall nature. So that's why I try to capture them in a something similar way. So this was on an early morning, somewhere around 7, just before the sunrise happened. And it was kind of a cloudy day, or a misty, heavy misty day. So that's why you really can't see the harsh sunlight which is coming out. So this was, again, like this poles, they, I think, Khanna, if you are familiar, they are doing an amazing job of protecting these animals. So they put fencing and they allow them to go only one part of the forest to graze on grass. So once that particular part is completely over, they open the fencing to the other part, and so that like this Barasinghas or the swamp deers, they have food throughout the year. So that these poles made a very interesting frame overall. Okay, and this is again in spotted deer, which I shot in, I think, even this was in Khanna. So the winter in Khanna is always very interesting. So the best part is like the spotted deer will have a velvet kind of cover on their horns when they are in I think mating season. So okay, so that hairy part will always make very interesting subject when the light is passing through them, because they'll have it somewhere in the golden color. So that makes very interesting. So this line what is going is in spider web, which is between these two twigs. Okay, and so there are a lot of different kind of images will come. This was shot in somewhere in Tumkur of an albino cobra. So they are first of all very rare, and thanks to my friends who run an NGO in Tumkur. So they were rescued this cobra from an a rice mill. Okay, and we were about to release them, and then there are a couple of them, like one normal and one albino one. So we were supposed to release that, and before releasing it, I just took one shot against the late evening sky, and there was no artificial light which is used, and this was shot on a 15 mm lower lens, 1:1 macro lens. So I would suggest like to know your subject very well before you try something or getting close to snakes, because a lot of my images are snakes images. So because I grown up watching them and watching their behavior, and when they are angry and how close I can go to them, and whether it is safe or not, which one is venomous, which one is non-venomous. So I request everyone not to go very close to any of the subject, like unless you know them very, very well. Okay, because that might be a very risky thing to do, not only for you, even for the subject. So that's why it's better to keep your distance between the subject and you. Okay, so there's a portrait of an tiger. So I'm not a very very much big cats guy. So why I put this image is to show how the overall perspective changes when you shoot something very close and wider frame. So for a person like me who doesn't know the real name of the tiger, or it does not make much difference like any other tiger, like whether this tiger or another tiger, for me it is just a tiger. So but like the thing what changes is the environment around the tiger, so that like anyone can differentiate between your each image. So that's why like these kind of images make more impact to me than the close-up or a portrait of an majestic animal, because they spend their lot of their life in these kind of areas, in grass or in hilly area between the jungle or an shy kind of animal. This was shot in Ranthambore, maybe I think 2-3 years back. This is again a tiger cub or an like subadult cub from Ranthambore. So I like the way it is sitting and looking, really not giving any importance to me or other photographers who are there. So it is always there, like tiger is always a tiger. So you, whether you are there or some celebrity is there, it doesn't give any major thing to them or importance to them. So but like the arch or the tree which is coming out of from the corner, which made a very interesting frame kind of thing. So that's why I took it on a wider side. Okay, so this is a rhino with the calf, which I shot in Manas National Park. So it was very, very fruitful day, I would say. This was shot at somewhere around 11 in the morning on a winter day, somewhere in, I think, December 23rd or 24th. So I was there in Manas. So this image is very special for me, not only to me, as well as Manas National Park. I think I wrote about this even in my when I posted this image. So what happened is, I think like due to some problems, like a lot of poaching happened in Manas National Park during the local riots or something. Okay, so the poachers took the advantage of local problems and they poached, almost everything was poached, and then government took a decision to translocate some of the rhinos from Kaziranga to Manas. And after that, this is the first calf which was born in Manas naturally, like without any artificial breeding technique or anything. This was the first calf which was born naturally. So that's why like this image will be always remembered, like even the forest department guy who was with me, and he was very, very happy after seeing this healthy rhino and calf. This I shot in Brazil. So I was on an office trip and I took one day off and like somewhere on the weekends, and I traveled to a close by destination and I shot this image. So there was no artificial light or an external flash, and I think like a lot of Central American places allow you to use a lot of artificial light and they have their own flash setup. Okay, so you just need to mount your camera and shoot it, that's it. Because these birds needs very high shutter speed, somewhere between I think 5,000 and 6,000 to freeze the wings. So that's why they do that. But in this case, I did not use any artificial light. So what I did is, there was a white color building and the wall which was there behind me, you can see it in the eye. Okay, so the light was coming from this angle and it was passing through the wings, and then it was hitting the white wall and getting reflected. So I used it as a natural reflector to get this shot. Okay, and this was shot in again, I think in Kana itself. So there was a one ray of light which was passing between two trees, and then this jackal came in, stood and gave a pose to us for a second, and I was lucky to get that. So you can see the light passing through this particular area, and it was just crossing over the jackal. So which I took it in color actually. So most of my, at least in macro shots, I shoot even in, the shots in black and white, just to get the feel of what are all the different color gradations are there in the frame. Okay, even though when you open it in camera raw, you get an color image, but I just want to get the feel that what levels of color gradations are there, what are all the different shades of grays you can get in that frame. Just to get that feel, I shoot in black and white on camera. So, but it will not be 100% accurate as your output, but like you can at least get the feel of what you might get as an output. So that's why I do that. So, but in this case, I did not have that much time, so I shot it directly on the color. Okay, so again, this is very common, I think, like most photographed bird wherever you go. So, but this was on a very early rainy morning. This was shot in Pench Tiger Reserve. So because of rain, so the forest fog was just raising from the ground. And then like this peacock was completely wet, and it, to dry its wings, it just came up on, sat on this particular fallen tree. And the triangle shape, what it is coming, and the parallel lines on the background, which made very interesting frame for me. So I just placed Allah in my Jeep in such a way that I don't cross any of these lines, and the subject comes exactly in between them. Okay. And again, like you don't have to really shoot from the top all the time or from the sides. Like when you have option, even the belly or the bottom part is also very interesting. So this snake is called as Boiga flaviviridius, and I think yellow-bellied cat snake, which is found in and around Bangalore and even Karnataka and the mostly dry deciduous kind of forest. Okay, so this was recently discovered, maybe I think 8-10 years back this was discovered. And actually, if you see the snake, it's very less colorful snake, okay, but the sunlight, the evening golden light which is passing through its body makes it very interesting. You can see that, like you can really see all the internal organs. So you can see the heart, and you can see the lungs which is coming from this part to here and everything. So that made very interesting feel, gave interesting feel to this image. Okay, and even the contrast, which makes very interesting sometimes, like this is shot on an Yana, you might be a lot of you might be knowing or seeing. So this and that volcanic rocks what we have, and those rocks are pretty much darkish or a bit very high contrast, and the green this one particular tree which grew in between where it had mud. So that gives a very interesting subject to photograph. Like you don't have to really show the complete picture of Yana, but still you can show something which is very contrasty and interesting. Okay, so this I shot it in the wide because to show the habitat. So this is called as sweetwater swamp, okay, which is very, very important to our ecosystem. So you can see what you can see here, these roots, right? They are kind of mangrove roots, but they are not. They are called as sweetwater swamps. Okay, so they'll have this kind of major roots all over the place in this swamp area. And this root speciality is they hold the water when it rains, and then when the rain is like rainy season is over, they start releasing the water in a slower manner. Like they don't allow water to just go away. They slowly release the water throughout the year. So that's why they are kind of major water source for the Western Ghat area, and there are, I think they are vanishing now because of a lot of different reasons. So but this particular place is full of life, okay? Like whatever you see, there are n number of frogs, insects, and wherever there are frogs, you see a lot of snakes and the species which depends on like or live by feeding on them. So that's why I just wanted to showcase the overall feel, and still like it's not the primary subject. So the gradually you can see the frame going out of focus. Yeah, and this I shot last year in Valparaiso. So with some of the subjects, like if you are giving enough time to them and if you are not disturbing them or like sitting very closely or quietly in a place, and even like how humans have very curiosity in the same way, even the monkeys or the primates are also very much curious. So I was just lying next to this particular the route, what you can see here, and with my 1635 on. And then like this particular individual was very curious to know why I'm sleeping there, and it came, and I got almost like 4 or 5 shots. So there was a white area on this part, and that was the reflection what you can see here on the eye. This I shot in Assam. So this is golden langur. I think like they are almost in the edge of extinction, or like they are in a very much threatened stage. And there are a couple of parts of Assam where you can spot them. This was on an early morning where the light was coming and falling on this particular monkey from the back. So that made very interesting. And the interesting part about this monkey is like, if you are familiar, so they will have a different color glow in their hair in the morning as well as evening. Okay, so morning light is always better to photograph these monkeys than in the evening light. So the hair changes colors, or like technically the light temperature reflecting from their hair is give you a different light altogether. So that's why the mornings are better for shooting these monkeys, golden langurs. Okay, and so I just wanted to show the habitat, how and where they will be and what kind of place they will be. So this was in somewhere near Sirsi, and usually they sit in this kind of areas where they spend a lot of their time in the daytime. They will just sit in one place so that like they don't get disturbed, and like in the evening they start going for hunt. So that the major reason for that is this species is mainly dependent on the heat sensing part. So they are called as pit vipers. They will have two heat sensing pits around their just below their nose. So they can sense like, I think like 0.02, I think, percent variation in the heat. So majorly they can see even in the day. What will happen is, since they are more dependent on the heat sensing part. So in the daytime, like it's a rock and then maybe a frog or an rat will have same temperature because of the sunlight. But when it's night, so the temperature on the rock will go down, and still a frog and rat will have same body temperature. So that's why they depend night, or they prefer night more than day. It's not that like they can't see in the daytime, but they prefer night more because of their body structure or the how they hunt. Okay, you can see a lot of them sitting next to a water source, because water source is the best place to find the frogs. So that's why they mainly feed on frogs. So that's why you'll see a lot of them in and around a water frog, a water source, or a stream which is running through a deep forest in Western Ghat area. Okay, so this image is just to show that nothing goes waste in nature. Okay, so this is looks like a blue banded bee. I'm really not sure because it's completely dead. So when it dies, so even mushroom grow through their body, because like they, it's the best food for mushroom to get. So that's why this is one way of cleaning in nature. Okay, so this is an velvet mite, so which was lying on a tree which was cut, I think, some days back, and like it was almost decaying. You can see that the acacia trees, what they cut will have, once they start decaying or like it becomes old, so you can see the different temperature or the colors on the cut part. So that's why I just wanted to take the different contrast in the image, and so that like I don't go very close to subject, but still I cover most of the part. This is again shot in natural light. I really don't know what this plant is called as, but they are the seeds. Okay, so the plant grows seed just below the leaf. So I wanted to show how they will be and how symmetrically they will grow. So this was shot somewhere around mid-afternoon, somewhere around, I think, 12:31, where sun is exactly above my head. And what I did is like I just underexposed the image so that like the background where I'm pointing at, that was a canopy area. It goes black and still I get all the contrast and light in the subject which I want. So that's how I shot this. Okay, and this I shot a couple of days back. Okay, so you don't have to go very close, because the surroundings, what you see or like what you get on the nature is always beautiful. So it's not necessary that like every time or a sunset what you see is just not because like it, if it looks very beautiful, it's not because of setting sun, because setting sun is always same. There is no change in the sun, but the surroundings, what is there and how your eye will see. So that and what are all the subjects around the sun, what your eye can see, that makes the sunset more appealing than the real sun setting, right? So that's why like you always see from the both the sides, whether how it looks if you go very close or how it looks if you come really far. So here it's a common dragonfly. There's nothing interesting in this, but the grass blades and the dewdrops which is there on the grass blade, that makes more appealing than the real dragonfly. So even the contrast on the dragonfly, which is really almost dark, so that makes very, very appealing on a green or a yellowish green background. So again, you can, when you are pointing your camera towards the canopy, you will see a lot of the white patches. So if you use a right aperture on your camera, so you can really get this rounds or a round kind of thing from the canopy. Okay, so if you place your subject in a right place, so you can really, even though it's a very wider frame, still you can take your viewer's eye to the subject where you want to show. So that's why like what I did is I placed this particular subject, or I framed it in such a way that the subject falls within the brightest area of my frame, and all others are little bit darker than this particular part. So even this particular part of the twig which is coming, and that's pointing you towards the subject. So that's what I felt, which is very interesting. So Russell, is this space fine, or do you want me to go bit faster?
No, this space is fine.
Yeah, it's okay.
Don't worry about the time.
Okay.
Okay, take your own time.
Okay. I'll try to go a bit faster, because I think I told you 45 minutes.
It's all No. Take your time. That's what I said. Don't worry about the time. Take your own time. Okay.
There is
no time limit for anything.
Okay. Yeah. Fine. So this I shot in Tadoba when I was waiting for a tiger to enter. So there are a lot of gypsies were there, and there was really nothing which was happening. And our gypsy was completely covered by other gypsies, so that we could not even move. And we had to wait for a long time. So then I saw that like this drongo, which was catching the dragonflies in flight, and it was trying to land on that particular tree, which was already dead. So what I felt is like it was against the sky, and somehow light was falling. So what I did is I just underexposed the image to great extent, or somewhere around 3 stops, where only the really bright area becomes something normal, and all other areas like which was normally exposed will go completely dark. Okay, only thing is like what I did is I converted to black and white so that I don't get this blue sky here, and I increase the contrast on the sky so that like the gray, it will not become gray and it becomes more towards the white. And you can see the dragonfly which is there on the mouth. Okay, these kind of things, like sometimes you will get lucky. Okay, so there is nothing great about my technique or anything. So they were literally sitting like this. Okay, sometimes you really get lucky. So they were both of them were sitting facing each other, and there was one which was walking in exactly in between this the frame. So this I call it as social distancing. So I think like that suits properly for the current situation. This was shot in Corbett. So I was just waiting for this this quail to make a call, and I intentionally added this particular frame. So because I had a 500 mm, and if I take the shot, it was very close. Okay, so if I took the shot, it's just an bird sitting on the perch. Like there is nothing. I can really get a very good portrait, and but I wanted to include this particular the burnt trees. They were forming a very beautiful line, and on that too, on a bit distance from the subject, so that they go bit out focused compared to the subject, but still like they are very much evident on the frame. You can see that like the whites what is there on the quail. Okay, so and the blacks and whites are almost very much my favorite subject. Like so I overexposed this image to somewhere around 3 stops, because you have seen something similar with the green background. The grass was almost yellowish green. So when you have the yellowish green, and if you increase the the exposure to almost something 3 stops, they will become almost white. Okay, so I just used the overexposing technique here, since the dragonfly was this is the different species, I guess, like it was completely dark. So that's why like I took that advantage and I overexposed the image, and the water droplets which was there on the grass was really complementing the image. Okay, and even the cloudy day sky can give you a very interesting perspective. So this was shot in JP Nagar Forest last year. So it was on a cloudy day, and nothing much was happening. So I just saw that snail going through this particular twig, and then I had to lie down and then frame it in such a way that the twig goes from one corner to another corner. And this was bonus. Okay, so I was not expecting this, or I did not even really know that like when I was shooting. So that was not intentional at all. But this was really intentional, like to shoot against the sky. Okay. And this frog, some of you might be knowing, this is called as the resplendent bush frog. This is one of the rarest frog what you get in India. They are found only in very few parts of Kerala. Maybe I think like maybe around 3 or 4 kilometer radius. So what happened is like I was shooting from the side, and even that came out really nice. But I wanted to show the top angle from this side, that how the structure of this one. And there was a kind of dead algae which was there, and the frog was sitting on that. And where I saw that the most part, root part of the algae was completely dead, and you can see the black, and only the end part of the algae was still green. I don't know. I'm not sure whether it is completely dead or how that's how that will be, but the end part was green in between. So because of rain, it was completely washed out, and like it was not standing. So then I thought that like these greens will add to the frame, and I took the frame, and to my luck, and the frog was literally given a proper pose, so that like the leg was open, one leg and everything. Okay, so this image, I think this is a pretty old image which I shot, I think in 2015, if I'm not wrong. This was again in Tumkur, and this cobra was facing against the setting sun, and I thought I will take the advantage of the top shot, and so I shot it with a very shallow depth of field, so that like only the surface which is exactly flat will come in 100% sharpness, and the remaining will go gradually blur. And thanks to the setting sun and where the light was come properly lit on the front part of the hood. And what you see here, that is the body of the snake, like it was coiled up. So because of the shallow depth of field, you really don't get the things in very much in detail. This was again shot in, I think, 2015 or 16. This is a saw-scaled viper. So saw-scaled vipers are mainly called saw-scaled vipers because of their scale is having the edge of the saw, right? Something similar to that. And apart from that, like they rub their body to generate a sound which exactly sounds like you're somebody's sawing something, like somebody's trying to cut a tree or a wood using saw. So that's how it sounds, okay? And the best part is like, even though the body is moving, it always keeps its head 100% steady, so that like it can concentrate on the target it needs to reach, and the body will go to show the aggression that like, don't really come near me. And this was shot with a slow shutter speed, somewhere I think like 1/30th of a second, to show the movement in the body, and still head remains still. And one interesting fact about this snake is like they are very, very accurate. Okay, so some of you might be knowing, and they don't miss the target almost 99% of the time. So, and they are very tiny. Okay, they hardly are 1.5 feet long, not more, not even 1 foot, I guess. Like there's a one species which is there in Rajasthan. They grow very big. That is called as again saw-scaled viper, but that is from the Rajasthan area. But what you get in the southern India and other parts, so they are very tiny. So you get them in and around Bangalore or Tumkur, where the hilly or rocky areas are there, and even Mangalore and other areas where the volcanic rocks mountains are there. Okay, so this concludes the first part and the natural light part. So hope I'm really not boring you. And the next one comes the combination of the artificial light as well as the natural light. Okay, so they are called as dancing frogs. The dancing frogs spend a lot of their life in fast flowing streams. Okay, they are either next to a waterfall on a rock or kind of that kind of fast flowing streams in where the lot of rocks are there in Western Ghat area. And what I wanted to showcase is the water flow which is going. So you can see the water flowing here and here, but still like the frog spends most of its life here. So that's why I just wanted to show that behavior. So they are even called as dancing frogs. Like it's not really a dancing as per me. Like they tend to show their leg or like open their leg to maybe threaten the other males. Okay, and so this is again in combination of artificial light as well as natural light. This was shot somewhere in the morning, 10:30-11 in JP Nagar forest. And you can use, if you are using an artificial light or a flash, then if you use the slower shutter speed, something less than, I think, 1/60th of a second, so then you can get the effect of natural light as well. Because like if you are having more than 100 or 150 shutter speed, then what happens is your shutter is so fast that like the light which is your artificial light overpowers the natural light, and your sensor really can't recognize the natural light. So So that's why, like, if you use the slower shutter speed even with the flash, then you can get some details in the background, which is created by natural light. This was shot in Valley School. Here we used an artificial light to get this the lid from the front, and there was a backlit natural light which was coming from the this particular left hand corner. So, and since the leaf was very tender, and we could see that, like, the most of the leaf became, say, translucent. This is again in Malabar pit viper. There's a very, very juvenile snake. Hardly this might be 4 inches or not more than that. So you can see that by the end of the tail, they will have this yellowish end when they are very much juvenile state. Here I used the texture of the dead tree. It was lying on a dead tree, and I used the texture of the dead tree along with the artificial light to create this image. Okay, this is again a combination of natural light and artificial light. So so as I showed you earlier, these frogs spend most of their life just next to a stream. So where I put in flash somewhere behind this frog, and then the water droplets, what is coming out of the waterfall. So there was only one shot which I got, because I wanted this shot very badly and I was trying for quite a long time. So what happened is, like, just I was waiting for this frog to croak, because I had no option of testing my shots, because the frog will jump if flash comes. So that's why I was just hoping everything is fine, and I was waiting for this particular frog to croak once, and thankfully it croaked once and flash fired, and because of flash it jumped. So I only got one image. So what you see here, the line is created by the sunlight which is falling from the left hand corner, and this particular glow is because of the flash which I used. Okay, this is again like the same frog where the when they are sitting very close to water falls or a flowing stream, so there is a lot of mist which comes out of that, because when the water is falling, so it creates a lot of mist. So I wanted to get the feel of that mist and along with the flow of the water, and that's why, like, what I did is I just used one particular flash from somewhere in this side, and to get this particular mist which is floating. Okay, and this is again I named this image as, like, we call it a tree and they call it a home. So because, like, for a tiny this gecko, so the whole life is just that tree. Okay, so not only for gecko, like lot of insects or species lot of flies, everything, like, they completely spend their whole life on the tree. So for us, it just might be a tree, and where we can really cut it, there's nothing much difference, right? So, but there are a lot of people who are a lot of species which is completely depending on the tree, and they spend the whole life in the tree, and they don't really go. So that's why we need to be more cautious, or passionate about other species as well. So that's why, like, I just took this shot to show the whole depth of the tree, and along with that where the gecko is sitting. And I used one LED torch on the left hand side to get this glow on the eye. And then comes the flash or a diffused kind of light. Okay, so I have a couple of images from that as well, to just to get the give the feel. Okay, so when you hit the light from the even if it is a diffused light or an harsh light from the front, you can get amazing colors and the details. But for me, personal, this is just a personal opinion. I don't have any thing. But for me, I don't really like this kind of image, because this becomes more of a two-dimension image than a three-dimension image, because, like, if there is not much shadow in the image, really, it flattens the image to a great extent. So that's why I'm really not big fan of that. But yes, if you want to use it for any scientific purpose or any research purpose, then that diffuse light makes lot of it will be lot of helpful thing. Like it will be really helpful to create this kind of image. It really helps to bring out the colors, details, everything to great extent and to the real color. Okay, this is again a flash which is fired from the front. And here I think like it was a very old image. I used an handkerchief to tie on the flash to diffuse it to certain extent, but I was not really successful in that. But somehow I made a decent image of a cat's neck. But why I like this image is because of the composition. So it really gives me a 3D feel, and it always takes your viewer's eye within the frame. So it doesn't allow you to go out of the frame. So it's because circle, right? So it takes your eye somewhere here, and then again it brings this circle brings you back to the main subject. So that's what made it a bit interesting for me. Okay, next comes the my favorite area where I use a lot of my friends says that like it's kind of like now new normal for me to use different artificial lights and in a different angle. Okay, so one suggestion. So the thing is like it's always good to get inspired by somebody else's image. Okay, so and I would suggest or I recommend to build your own way of photographing things. You don't have to stick to anything. Like you can do your own composition. You can do everything by your own. So try to develop a skill or a particular style of photography where people really can recognize you by the image. You don't have to go and tell that this is my image. So I think that makes a lot of difference for a photographer. That too, in today's date, like I think like we have very advanced camera. Almost everything will be done by camera because I was trying an R5 last week. Somebody bought it. And like even on a frog, that really does the animal eye detection function. Like even that detects the eye and it focuses to exactly eye. And then what me as a photographer bringing to table, that's what makes more important than the equipment now. Because like equipment, you are focusing, sharpness, color, everything is done by camera without much of a problem. But now the main thing what matters is you as a photographer, what you bring to plate or the table is what creates something impactful or like make you different from others. So now onwards, whatever the images I used is like, or what I'll be showing is using the artificial light. It's not necessarily that like I used the flash or torch because I have a tendency to experiment with the light. Okay, so that's why like I use multiple flash and then I use torch light to lit something and different colored torch, everything. So that's why like I think like I'll just go one by one image and like if something interesting, I'll explain you. Or else if you have any questions, you can ask me in the end. There's no problem at all. This is the cicada which is molting, which I shot in Valparai. So the tenderness, like when they molt, so cicada, you might be knowing, they will have blue color blood, okay, because of the copper content, what will be there in their in the blood. So you can see that in the initial stages, they will have bluish blood. And what you see here in the veins, they that's the blood. Okay, and when they start warming up, then the blood color changes. I think like, I really don't know the scientific phenomena. But it's because of the copper content what is there on their blood. Okay, and this is an grasshopper which is molting. Okay, and molting creates sometimes like very interesting patterns. Okay, so you can see that exactly symmetric pattern which was created by the molting grasshopper. So, and the interesting part is like they always choose. So if you know your subject very well, or if you try to study your subject or you are very keen to observe them. Okay, so I have never seen them holding something which is bigger size than their paw. Okay, so they always choose the right perch. I don't know how it is possible, but like they always choose the perch which is exactly fits their size. Okay, because the molting process will take a lot of effort because it shakes because of the wind, and even because of the breaking the old shell, a lot of shaking will be there because the grasshopper moves around, and it will be very, very tender, so that it will not be able to really move away, but it need to hold to this particular part. Though still, like, because of the technique, how they hold it, like, it takes the weight, complete weight of this, and without even falling. I have seen it in several times. Okay, I have, I think, one more image which I can show that. Okay. And rain is again my favorite. Like, I try to capture the rain in a different way. Okay, so for me, like, getting the rain as rain is very much important. Okay, so the thing is, like, a lot of times I tried and failed miserably, because like rain drops were coming like in drop or in it was not really a rainish field. So the rain field should be like a strike or a straight lines, right? So that's why, like, I tried really hard to get these things perfectly, and somehow I could get some images, I think, like, with a very high shutter speed on an using an flash. And light and shadows are very much important, in at least in my photograph, because I feel they are more important than the light. So that's why, like, I use shadows to a great extent. So this was shot with one flashlight, which is firing somewhere from here. I really did not wanted to show the whole part of the body, only I wanted one line or one side of the body to lit, and all others should be like, you can imagine whatever you feel. So that's why, that's how I wanted to project it. And I used one slight mobile torch to lit the eye of this side, because the eye on the right side, sorry, this side is not visible. So I just wanted to still get the feel of the eye on the which I can see. So that's why I used a mobile torch to get the eye a little bit on the frame. And the same day I shot this as well. So this is how you play the light. This was shot with one flash, which is from the down, which was lighting this particular part. And there is one torch light, which was fired from this corner on the right hand corner, where you can see the line which is coming out of that. This is again a green wine snake for your eyes. This shot, I shot it a couple of days back. Dragonfly, which is molting. And this is what I was talking about. I made a small time-lapse video of this whole sequence. Okay, I saw them in hundreds molting on at night. So this was shot somewhere from 10 in the night to till or for next 3 hours. So the whole process took somewhere around 3 hours. So I was waiting for that. And then once it reached this stage, and it will take a lot of time to go to the next stage. So that's why I stopped my time lapse, and I took a couple of shots like this, and I just closed for the day. And I'll explain you when the video is going on. And mushrooms are again one of my favorite subjects. So on a rainy day, this was on a raining day, and the mushroom, and this was not even, I did not use any flash here. This was two torches, LED torches. One from this particular side, and the one to lit the mushroom. Okay, so this was the problem which I was talking about. I could not initially get the rain in the way real rain shows. So this kind of water droplets are, I can see as a rain. This is a biluminous mushroom which I shot in Valparaiso last year. So this was I was waiting for this kind of mushroom from quite a long time. Okay, so thankfully I was able to get it in Valparaiso last year. And the very interesting part was, like, when I was shooting this, so you need a really long exposure to get this light. Okay, so else you are hardly, we really can't see with our normal eye whether it glows or not. So what happened is, like, this image took almost, like, I took for 5 minutes exposure, and I had to have a very lightless night. So, and Valparaiso is very famous for leopards, if you know. And what happened is I had opened my shutter for 5 minutes, and like literally I could hear alarm calls from sambar deer in somewhere around 200 meters and closing towards me. And I really can't open or switch on my torch because like the image will go off. And the bad part is when you open your shutter for 5 minutes, then what will happen is like your sensor will start getting hot and then you will start seeing the red pixel. So if you zoom in very closely, you can see the red pixel even in this one. Okay. So I knew that I don't have any other option than the only one shot. So somehow I controlled my emotions to wait till at least 4.5 minutes, and then the alarm call became very close, and then at 4.5 minutes I had to stop the shutter and then switch on the torch. And we were lucky that like we could really hear leopard walking somewhere around 10-15 meters away from us within the bushes. And again, like I told you, the pattern what makes a lot of difference. So there was this Malabar Pitu Aipur was sitting just next to a stream. I used an overhead torch to flash to lit the subject, and then on the sides here I used an torchlight to get this water droplets which is flowing. Like that's how I shot it. And the juvenile snakes are always very interesting to shoot because like you get a lot of translucent part of the body. So this was a juvenile cat snake which I shot last year. And I used two different flashes, one from this corner and one from this corner, to lit both the lines on the body. And some of you might be knowing this is a body or a hair of a caterpillar. This shot was done in Valparaiso. So when I saw that, like I saw that. Sorry for that. Okay, they are the dogs which is there on the road, and they become furious in the evening. The hair was pretty yellowish, and in between the hair had the blackish part in that. So what I did is I fired a flash from the behind, and I underexposed the image. So the flash was overexposed so that like I get the yellow part or the yellow orangish part in highlight, which if I just fire the flash in overexposure mode, so what will happen is it will burn out. So what I did is I underexposed the camera and overexposed the flash so that like I get these things in proper, so that like the darker area will become more darker. So that's why you feel that the flame which is coming out of it. So, but really there are black part here, which is now not visible because of the camera technique. And the mayflies were my favorite subject, and this year I could get a couple of them. So I think in one of the outing on a Sunday, so me and Pawan was there along with Chinmay. So we could get this shot. So I was really happy with this. So I used one external or two external flashes. So whenever I use external flashes without diffuser, I use it in manual mode because I want to control the amount of light which is coming in. Because if I use the TTL, it really gives me it will not allow me to control the flash in a complete way. So that's why what I use is I use flash in manual mode, and I prefer to use it with the very less intensity. Maybe most of the time I use it with 1/128 of a second. So that I don't have any overexposed area or in blown out area. But still, I compensate that with my shutter speed and the aperture how I want it. This is a termite hill gecko juvenile, which I shot a couple of weeks back in one of my friend's farmhouse. We were just shooting something in the night, and we saw this fellow on a dead tree. So I just placed, thankfully, like he was very cooperative. I placed my flash just behind this fellow so that like I get the complete translucent body, because since it was in juvenile one, so they will have all the juveniles will have translucent body. As they grow, the skin becomes thicker. So that's why like I managed to get, and to lit this side eyes, I used an LED light from from mobile so that like the light, the eye can be visible from this side. Okay, this I think like you have already seen on the cover page or of this particular session. This I made last year during night, because what will happen is the species which are active during the day will become mostly inactive during the night. So that's why like you get a lot of option to shoot them, but I suggest not to disturb them to a great extent. So what I do is I use a very light flash from very far distance. Maybe I'll take one or two shots, not really 30 or 20 shots, okay, because like they, I don't really want to disturb them. So I made a setting, like what I do is I choose something similar leaf when I'm doing the test shot, so that like I don't really disturb them during the test shot. I take the test shot on a different leaf which doesn't have any anything sitting on that. And like once you feel that your exposure or the angle of the light which you need is 100% perfect, then you can just set your flash and trigger your or frame the subject and then just trigger two shots. You have a, whatever you need in that two shots. You don't really have to test your skills on that particular thing and disturb it, or like it will fly away, or like I don't really want to do that. So that's why I test my shots on something else, and then as the final result, I just put it to my subject and I shoot it. Okay, this was shot last week here near my home. Okay, this is again a mayfly, and this was shot just with torchlight. Okay, there was literally no flash used, and the one torch which I placed in such a way that it only lights the subject, and the other one from this corner so that I get the gradual light here. So thankfully this mayfly was very much still, so that's why I even could get it with a very, very slow shutter speed. This is again a dancing frog. I just wanted to highlight only the eye part. And the interesting part was like I do a lot of experiment, okay, like with my equipment. So this side I could place a on the left hand side, I could place a flash with very less intensity. Unfortunately, right side was completely water. So thankfully, I had a plastic zip cover. So what I did is I put another flash inside zip cover, and to make it submerged. So I tied a big rock to my flash, and I literally kept it inside water. So this light, what you see, is the one which is passing through the water and hitting this particular frog. And this again in the katydid, which is molting. So they will, katydids, like with the long wing, they have very interesting pattern on their wing. Okay, when they are very tender, they'll have the translucent body as well as wing. Just one request, when you are shooting this kind of thing, like as I told you earlier, they are very much tender, and they're not very safe or like very active. So just take a couple of shots, and if you already have a very good shot, then really don't try to disturb them to the great extent, because nowadays, even if I see this kind of phenomena which is happening, I don't really take the shots, because I already have the shot and there's no meaning in shooting the same thing again and again, so that like I don't disturb them on a regular basis. So and if you are shooting, then do it from a far distance, like, or use the flash from not from very close and from far distance on a very less intensity. You can compensate on your camera to get the required shutter speed by increasing the ISO or something, or you can make your sensor sensitive to light so that like you don't disturb the subject to that extent. This was shot in JP Nagar Forest. Again, like this was using the artificial lighting, flash, one flash which is floating from the right hand corner and one from the down part of the left hand corner, so that I get only the lines on the twig. This again, I shot it in JP Nagar. So this is a very common subject which everyone can see, the millipede. So, but interesting thing is millipede's body, some species millipede's body is like very much transparent. Okay, some of them are, I think, like they are not as transparent as this. So whenever you have the transparent body, what will happen is if you fire a flash, it tend to reflect. Sorry, not transparent. I'm completely wrong on that. Okay, so the shiny surface and a light tend to reflect. So what I did is I just wanted only the reflected light part in the frame, and everything else should go dark. So I used one flash and I underexposed the image by 5 stops so that like the darker part or the non-reflective part of the body will completely go dark, and only the reflective part will have the overexposed area will become something which is normal. So that's how I shot this. This I shot couple of, I think, months back. I think once the lockdown opened, so in and around Bangalore, we tried to go out. I wanted to showcase, this is how the image was shot. I did not crop it. So I wanted to just show the tail part of the scorpion, because you don't have to really show the whole scorpion to tell that it's a scorpion. So because the sting or the tip of the tail is the most important part of scorpion's body. So this is the place where they store the venom, and they are the crucial part of the body. So that's why I just wanted to show that. So you can see that like only that part. So here I used 2 flashes. So one from this side and one for this side to get the side lighting. That's it. Just give me a second, guys. Let me see. We are almost done. My bad. Okay. So this, like, I like to see the patterns or some geometrical shapes in the nature. So if you'll see that very regularly in my image. So somehow, or I really don't intend to do that, but like I think like somehow my mind always finds that happening in most of the images. So this was like the parallel lines which is going and then exactly two legs which is connected to that parallel wings, which made very interesting to look for. This is, I call it as the migration. Okay, they are very young or juvenile spiders. They are just, I think, hatched. Okay. So what happened is on a night, me and my cousin, we were just walking in our backyard. What happened is we got to see this the spider hatchlings. Okay, there are hundreds of them. Like they were huge in number, and the one clutch was on the below part, and the other clutch we could see few of them on the top. And we just started watching them, and then what happened is the very interesting thing happened. The mother, every time mother used to come down to the main clutch, which is there on the bottom, and then like after a second or two, and it will go back. And whenever mother goes back, so there will be 10 or 15, the young ones, which will be following the mother. And she goes up and she leaves them on the top, and then again, she comes back. Okay. And this happened for almost like 3 hours. Okay. So I watched for 3 hours. And I really did not want it to disturb much. So I just took a couple of shots, but I really watched it for 3 hours. And then it was still going on. And then we just came back. But it was very, very interesting, because like, how things happen in nature. So if you are very keen to observe things, I think like there are a lot of things which will happen in nature and which we can learn from. And it's not necessarily that you need to photograph everything. At least I don't do. So if something very interesting is happening, I sometimes keep my camera aside and just enjoy the moment. Okay, so that makes more interesting, because like I don't really shoot something to compete with somebody or like to commercially do anything. So that's why I have that lenience to just keep my camera away and watch it. And the angle of the light, which makes something very interesting. So this image gives an point that there are two garden lizards. Okay, but because of the light angle, it looks like that, but technically there is only one, the shadow which is falling on this. It's because of the curve on the leaf, like the how the leaf is curved and the angle of the light which is creating this particular thing. And me and my cousin were walking in our arecanut plantation, and somehow, I don't know why, he just put a torch from this angle, okay? So then I was on the other side and I saw this happening. Then after that, okay, then we thought that, okay, we will have to shoot this particular frame with the same field. So that's like we use torchlight to get this. Okay, we use two torchlight, one with the wider one where it doesn't point directly to subject to lit the whole frame, and then one little harsh one from the distance to get this the rim light. This technically I did not plan anything. This happened just because I was shooting this particular frog from somewhere here, and then it just started moving. And because it was a juvenile frog, you can see the translucent body and the internal organs here. In this one, I had to open the eye a bit on the post-processing side because really I did not have much light from this side. But there was one flash which was used from the right-hand top corner to get this particular ridge or the twig which is in this color. This is technically not a very great image, I would say, but like the interesting fact on this image is if you are familiar with the frogs, there are two kinds of vocal sac. They will have this part, what you see is called as vocal sac, from where they amplify their the sound, okay? They call the call what they make, the male frogs. They because the number is so high and they are so tiny creatures, they should amplify the sound to reach more females. So that's why they use this particular vocal sac as an medium to amplify the voice. So there are two. One is called a side, which will have mainly for the frogs which are dependent more on the water. They will have they'll be floating. So that's why they'll have side vocal sac on both the sides, and the terrestrial frogs or the frogs which are there on the ground or tree or bush frogs, kind of tree species, they will have one just below their neck. Okay, so this image, why I shot it, because like this was shot in Mizoram, or I would say like somewhere near the Myanmar border. We were searching for snake, and then what happened is like we were just watching or sitting for some time. And I saw this frog croaking and the bubbles like, or the ripples which is coming out of it. I wanted to capture that. So this is the way the sound flows through water. Okay, so these are all the ripples what you see here. They are just because of the sound what is did by this particular frog that created these ripples in the water. So I just wanted to capture that particular ripples. And this is an Malabar gliding frog, which a lot of people might have shot this. So this was sitting on a tree where plant and holding this particular the base of the plant. I used one torch light from the back to get the glow on the leaf, and one mobile torch from the front to lit the frog. And last year somewhere I tried my hands with pit viper against star trial, not exactly star trial, I think it's galaxy, and I was not really successful. Okay, this was an in-camera double exposure image. The first exposure with a flash, I took it for this particular snake, and then I just changed the focus point and switch on and change the camera setting to this particular the sky, and I took a shot of 30 seconds or 25 seconds on a wide angle lens. And if you know the double exposure concept, I think like whatever is in the dark is visible, and anything which it goes to a brighter area, that becomes transparent kind of thing. So I could not really get a best image out of it. Hopefully I'll try this year if possible to create something better than this. And this one image where you don't have to really show the whole body of the subject to to get an interesting image. So this was inspired by an image which shot by one of the British or like European photographer and a friend. So he shot some image, something like this in Madagascar, and I saw that image and I was really, really, I don't know, like I got hooked to that image. So I had to recreate that image. And even I sent it to him, and he was very happy with the what I got. And that's why I told, like, there is nothing wrong in getting inspired by somebody else's work. And it's better to give the credit to that photographer so that, like, his ideas or the creation, what he has done, is not gone waste. So that's why. So it's always better to get inspired by somebody and try to develop your own skills or the style of photography when it comes to as a bigger medium. This, I don't know, like, this is not from the Lord of Rings. So a lot of people asked me that question. So this is an eye of an hump-nosed pit viper. This is shot from very close distance. So I placed my flash in such an angle that there was a white line which is running over the face of the hump-nosed pit viper will get lit, and the other two portion will go dark. So the flash was triggered from somewhere on the right-hand corner, and that to the image was underexposed to such an extent that, like, only the overexposed area became normal, and the underexposed or the normal the exposed area become completely black. So that's how I shot this image. And definitely there are little bit post-processing is done to reduce this part to bring the attention to only to eyes, but not much. This is a plant hopper, which I shot a couple of days back. And I don't really know, they are very, very interesting. Like, I always get fascinated by this kind of tails. And at least I don't know why they have this kind of tail. So maybe somebody who is experienced then in that field can help. So, but they're very interesting looking. So I think a lot of English movie guys will get this kind of subject will be inspiration for the alien related movies, I guess. This is large scale lizard, which I shot in Munnar. This was shot with two torchlight, one from the other side and one which is there on my head. And I had to climb a very thin tree to get this image. Okay, I'll show you that particular image. that's why I just put that shot. This is this year's, I think, as of now, favorite image which I shot. Maybe I think like a month back, I came to Sirsi. And we were on an walk in a forest. So what happened is this orange moth, pit viper came. We saw that in the afternoon, and we waited because we knew that, like, in the evening it starts moving. So we wanted to get the shot. So we waited for almost like 4 hours, and we walked around and we came back, and then rain started pouring. I usually don't really stop shooting when it rains. So yes, of course you need to protect your gear, but still I do shoot. Okay, so it's my personal preference. So what happened is I was just trying to get an water droplet just coming below the head, and I was shooting that, and suddenly what happened is because of the rain and one drop which fell on this head and which I saw through my viewfinder because it was under canopy, so it really flashed. Okay, so but at that time I did not had flash on the other side. So, but I got really surprised to see that through my viewfinder. And then me and a couple of friends were there. I told them that, like, you might need to wait for some more time because I just want to try this shot. And we waited almost for what, like 50 minutes or something. I was literally very, very cautious to get one shot. So that's why I did not even move my eye from viewfinder. And there was one flash which was set up here and one on the left hand corner. So if you know that they are very very much still kind of snakes, right? They don't move around very quickly unless you disturb them. So thankfully at around 50-52 minutes I got this particular water fell few times. Okay, and once it fell on the eye, once somewhere it fell on the neck, and something on the snout, all these things. Finally, at 50th or 52nd minute, I got one shot which exactly fell on the middle of the head and it splashed, and my camera was on burst mode, and I could really make one very decent image from this particular frame. This was very, very interesting image, and which is very close to my heart. Okay, so now I think I am done with the images. I'll just show you a couple of videos which I made during this particular one for the cicada molting part, and the other one for the for 1 2-minute video which I made. Okay, so this is the time lapse video, and it might not really be very great quality, but to just to get the feel that how it happens. So they will be in this stage and inside the water, and when the it's time to hatch and like or to mold, they will come out and they try to hold a grass or something which is of their size, and they will mold. Okay, it took around 3 hours to complete the video, but I think it was still going on, but I just left after that. So okay, I have not really edited this clip yet, so there is one. I'll do it sometime. This tomorrow is anyway Sunday. I'll try to do it. So there is one more video which I made some days back. I think some of you might have already seen it. I'll just play it for this. Is not take more than 2 minutes. So I'll just. This was from the different clips I made. So nowadays, I'm making some small clips whenever it is possible. So this is from that particular one. So I'll just reduce the down sound so that like I did not really had that the natural sound. So that's why I had to put some music. The next one I try to get the natural sound. These are all the places usually I go in search of different things. It's called large-eyed. That is the eye which just came out. Yeah, that's it. Okay, I am done with my presentation, Russell. So I think like I took really long time. Hope
No.
People did not leave.
Not at all. We didn't feel like that you have taken so much of time. It was very interesting. Without wasting time, I think let's open up the question and answer session.